All right, welcome to New Hope Church on Easter Sunday morning. He is risen. Amen. I'm glad you know that. If you kind of hadn't hung out in church a whole lot in your life, kind of a common practice to do is when somebody on Easter morning says, "He is risen," you respond with, "He is risen indeed." All right? So that was the reason for doing that. And thank you for so many of you remembering. If you are a guest here today, it is our privilege and our honor to have you in our Easter 2016 service. You are in for a treat. The choir is really, really good. You're going to enjoy them. But we'd love to know of your presence here today. If you're sitting in a pew, if you're on the front row, sorry, okay. But there are guest or communication cards in the back of the pew. We'd love for you to fill one out, drop it in the offering when it comes by. We promise not to beat on her door, bother you on the phone, but through the mail, put some information in your hand that tells you what goes on at New Hope Church. And so we'd love for you to do that. Not going to do too many announcements or things today. There's the highlights of what's coming up in April. Don't forget, next Saturday, all right, is the movie Saturday. God's Not Dead 2. If you have a tough time believing in the resurrection, go see God's Not Dead 2, all right? And there's a brand new book out that's really, really good that contains some good information on the subject of the resurrection that coincides with that movie. But just take note of those other things there, and we'll highlight those more in the coming Sundays. Please look at the pictures that are in there. Three of four significant events that New Hope was engaged in during Easter week. Right at the top, of course, is our Mexico mission trip. How many do we have in this service that you just got back last night from the Mexico mission trip? Would you stand, please, that you're in this service? Stand up. We want to see it. Come on, stand up. Be bold. Be brave. All right, look at that. Look at that. Woo! And I know we had a few that got baptized. All right, I know there's some. Any of you standing got baptized? Oh, way to go, girl. All right. So, important decision. Did I see Gil and Thelma stand? Oh, there was, okay, we'll see them in the next service, because I know they went as well. 66 from New Hope went down to Mexico, and I understand that 66 came back. And so that's a good thing. That's a good thing. All right. But anyway, they did a great job on their project, on their ministry outreaches. Gil got to preach, I understand, almost every night in Spanish, so he had to be in heaven. And folks, I know, enjoyed him. On Wednesday night, in our children's ministry building, Road to the Resurrection, we had over 125 come through in small groups of 5 to 15, parents with kids, grandparents, uncles and aunts with nieces, and they found out what it was that Jesus did that week of Easter. And every room was decorated differently and a different message taught in each room. And it was a terrific night. Our children's ministries did great. On Friday, we had some small groups who went with Rescue Mission and helped feed the homeless. All right. And so an outreach there. And then about 9 or 10 from New Hope were engaged in the prison fellowship event at VSP, Valley State Prison, out of Chowchilla for men. And what a great day that was. Over 50 men gave their lives to Jesus Christ. And that was awesome. And guys, the guy who kind of gave the closing message and the invitation, his name is Dean Johnson. He's about 6'2" or 6'3". He's got about a 48 or 50 inch wide chest. He's about 29 inches at the hip. God, I hated him. And articulate, had a great story. He broke a bat over his thigh. He took Coke cans and crushed them. He took a telephone book and tore it in two. He took a rebar, cement rebar, in his teeth and touched the tips down here. Oh, it was impressive, all right? But then he shared his message, and when he gave the invitation, he said, "Men, I'm not going to ask you to pray a quiet prayer right where you stand." And he said, "You need to be identified in this prison as a follower of Jesus Christ. I'm going to ask you to come up and stand right here in front of me." And those men got up from all over the place, man, and walked up. And 20 in the early service and about 31 or 32 in the second one. It was an incredible best. See, that's how I know that Satan took a day off yesterday. Yesterday went perfect. All right, perfect. So we caught him by surprise. But today, we're still going to whip him, because this is resurrection morning. I think I've covered those things. I'm going to ask our usher to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, would you come, please? While we receive our morning offering, I'm going to be reading to you the events of Easter Sunday morning. But let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for your love for us. That love was demonstrated in the gift of your Son. And by your Son, it was demonstrated by the giving of his life. He died so our sins could be forgiven, and he rose again so we could have new life, so we could have everlasting life. Father, we thank you that we have this day, that the world stops and pauses. Even if they choose to ridicule, they have to acknowledge this day is Easter Sunday. It's Easter not because there was a bunny rabbit that laid an egg, though that would have been somewhat of a miraculous event. It is not the purpose of Easter. The purpose of Easter is to remember that he is risen, and he is risen indeed. Thank you for the privilege of doing that today, for the privilege of giving. We say thanks. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Amen. Here is the way John records it in the Gospel of John, chapter 20. You may follow along if you want to in a Bible, or you can just simply listen as I read it to you. John wrote it this way: early on the first day of the week. How early, John? While it was still dark, Mary of Magdala went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one who Jesus loved, and she said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." She suspected that the Roman soldiers had stolen his body. Now, what's interesting about that is, in the next chapter, or over in Luke's story, the Roman soldiers tell everybody the disciples stole him. So this was one big con job, is what everybody's thinking. Verse 3, so Peter and the other disciples, they started for the tomb, and both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter, and he reached the tomb first, and he bent over, and he looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but he didn't go in. And then Simon Peter, who was behind him, he was a slower runner, he arrived, and he ran into the tomb, and he saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. And finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, went inside also. He saw and he believed. And then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood outside the tomb crying. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. Don't you think when Mary went back and told the disciples what happened, John and Peter were a little annoyed that they ran so quickly from the tomb? They should have stayed. The angels ask her, "Woman, why are you crying? Well, they have taken my Lord away, and I don't know where they've put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was him. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying?" I think she's getting tired of hearing this question. "Who is it that you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener. Thinking that Jesus, the Savior, was a gardener. Who have you thought he might be sometimes? Based on the way you have treated him at times in your life, who have you thought Jesus was? Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni." She saw, the first to see, the risen Savior. A decade and a half or more later, the Apostle Paul writes about this subject of the resurrection. There's some debate going on at that time of whether it was true or not. And so Paul wanted to address it. And so he wrote this in verse 14 of chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians. He said, "If Christ had not been raised from the dead, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith." In other words, if what we're celebrating today is not true, let's just go home. There's no value. You see, the hinge pinch of Christianity is not whether the Bible is true. Don't misunderstand me. I believe it is. That's not the hinge pinch. The hinge pinch of Christianity is, do you believe in the resurrection? Was Jesus raised from the dead? And that's what we're going to hear in music and a message today. He is risen. He is risen indeed. If you paid any attention to the sign out front, you know that what we're going to talk about today is the world's greatest comeback. And I believe that took place 2,000 years ago on what you and I now know as Easter Sunday morning. However, if you were to Google world's greatest comebacks, you're going to get lots of options to choose from, lots of different perspectives on this word comeback. One version of comeback are verbal responses to questions. Here's a few examples I found on Google. Remember when I asked for your opinion? Me neither. Now that's a comeback, all right? Here's another one. Mom, stop. You're not funny. You never make jokes. I made you, didn't I? There's a comeback, all right? Oh, baby. Abe Lincoln one time was called two-faced. And after being called two-faced, he replied, "If I had another face, you think I'd wear this one?" After an opera performance, an audience member asked Calvin Coolidge, "What do you think of the performer's execution?" He replied, "I'm all for it." Now, those are comebacks, but that's not the kind of comeback I'm interested in talking about today. I don't mean to be sexist, but most of us men, there are probably a few of you ladies who would fit in with us men as well, but when we think of comebacks, we think about great sports comebacks. We think of guys like Montana and Elway and Brady and Favre, and teams like the Yankees and the Red Sox and the Lakers all had great comebacks in their history. And in fact, we don't have to go very far back if you want to, just to last Sunday, for one of the greatest sports comebacks of all times. Many of you probably read about it, the Texas A&M basketball team in March Madness. Freshman Admon Gilder made a steal, and he scored at the end of regulation time to complete the Aggies' comeback from a 12-point deficit in the last 34 seconds against Northern Iowa. It was the stuff every kid dreams of playing on the driveway back at home. And in fact, as it turns out, that's where his parents were heading when he scored the goal at that critical moment. They were in their car on their way home. They had left 1 minute before the game was over. They were walking to their car when somebody yells, "Hey, Admon hit a layup." They watched the double overtime in their car on their way back to Dallas. They said they were sorry they weren't there to see that, but they loved their son anyway. The Aggies went on to win that game 92-88 in double overtime, advancing to the Sweet 16. Gilder, that freshman, said his parents missed the moment because they had work the next day. His mom in a dental office, his dad in the Dallas charter school system. Gilder said that his parents would not leave Thursday night's game against Oklahoma until the clock hit zero. They could have. It would have been okay in that game. Other great comebacks, oh man, us 49er fans, we remember that 38-14 shellacking we were getting with 4 minutes left in the third quarter, and they came back and won the game. Paul Azinger, most of us should know the golfer, 1993 PGA champion. He missed the 1994 campaign with cancer in his right shoulder. He recovered after missing a full year of playing, and he resumed competing, and he won another championship. Many of us saw this movie, the movie about Jim Morris. He was that 35-year-old high school chemistry teacher. That was back in 1999. As a young man, he was a pitcher in the minor leagues. But his dreams of Major League Baseball were ended by an injury that required major surgery. Years later, he was coaching the school team in his hometown of Big Lake, Texas. And Morris discovered by a fluke that he could still throw the heat, man. So he makes a deal with his high school team. If they will make it to the state finals, he will try out for the major leagues again. So his squad delivers. Morris goes to the Texas camp of the Tampa Devil Rays. And there he amazes everybody, even himself. He throws 98 miles an hour. It's in a few months, he's throwing in the big leagues. Come back. Jennifer Capriati. Some of you remember that name, right? Tennis star, French Open semifinalist at 14. A broken-hearted victim of broken dreams by age 18. She was accused of shoplifting, underwent psychiatric treatment, a drug arrest, and a substance abuse program. Then a new century turns. 2000, New Capriati. She won the Australian Open in 01, followed with a victory in the French Open in June of that year, and then another Australia triumph in 02. For you NASCAR fans, do you know Ernie Irvin? Okay, glad you do. I never heard of him. But he crashed his car. Good comeback story. He crashed his car. At a race at Michigan Speedway in 94, he was given a 10% chance of living. The odds were against him ever recovering from critical brain and lung injuries. But less than 1 year later, in October of 95, Irvin not only entered a NASCAR race, but he finished a remarkable sixth place. And if Irvin did nothing more than finish out of the money as a NASCAR driver, his comeback would have been nothing short of miraculous. But he did more than merely compete. He won two races in 1996. All these stories involve comebacks, coming back and winning when they weren't supposed to, coming back against overwhelming odds to become champions. And I'm here to suggest to you this morning, that's exactly what happened, except an even bigger magnitude on that very first Easter morning. You see, guys, on Saturday, Jesus was dead. Dead and buried. He had been crucified. He had died. He had been put in a tomb for a few days. His family, his friends, his disciples, they were overwhelmed with grief. The game was over. No time left on the clock. The other team, the Pharisees, apparently the bad guys, they had won. Game, set, match. The disciples, the followers of Jesus, the team members, they were brokenhearted. They were in a state of shock. They felt like they'd been kicked in the chest. And on top of that, most of them were terrified. Their star player, their team leader, had been crushed and eliminated from the game. They were in hiding, afraid that they might get the same treatment Jesus got. So they cowered in their homes, not knowing what to do. Ladies, you saved the day a bit. You didn't stay on the sidelines. On Sunday morning, you were not afraid to go to the tomb. Even though it seemed like the team was going through a down time, you made a straight for the tomb on Sunday morning. You were going to do for Jesus what you had not had time to do in their rush to bury him. They were going to prepare his body properly. The game may be over, and the team leader may be vanquished, but life must go on. There are exceptions. But almost every team goes through some lean years when the best way to describe their performance is they stink. Isn't there times like that in your life? There are times in life you say it sucks. It's pitiful. There's no leadership. Kind of like the 1971 NBA championship when Willis Reed, the New York Knicks center. How many of you remember Willis Reed? You remember that? I remember that because that's when I really started liking the Lakers. And I was, sorry, guys, but I thought the Lakers were going to win the championship that year. They had Wilt Chamberlain. And then in dramatic comeback, you see, Reed got injured. Said he probably would not play again. But Reed comes out to play. The Knicks are energized. They go on. They win the championship. Now, folks, I'm here to tell you, Jesus didn't have a knee injury. He's dead. And when you're dead, you just don't suck it up and play hurt. You don't put a brace on and deal with the pain. Jesus was dead. No comebacks, no ninth inning, fourth quarter heroics when you are dead. The disciples have no hope that their leader can come back and lead them to victory. So all the followers are grieving, they're depressed, they're discouraged, they have lost what all of us need to live, they have lost all hope. We all know that 3 days is not enough time to get over your grief. And the women who had gone to prepare the body, they come running up to the disciples, breathless, and they tell them, the body's gone, he's not there, well, where have they taken him? They really thought that the Romans had stolen him. Great, it's not bad enough. The star player has been taken out of the game. He's not even in the stadium. The fans suspected theft instead of resurrection. I wonder sometimes the way in which we live, if we don't live more like Jesus' body had been stolen rather than raised from the dead. On one occasion, Michelangelo. Y'all remember him? They still teach Michelangelo in school. Do you know who Michelangelo is? Good. Okay. Good. Good, good. Just checking, all right? Famous artist. He turned to his fellow artists and he said with frustration in his voice, "Why do you keep filling gallery after gallery with endless pictures of the one theme of Christ's weakness? Christ on the cross, Christ hanging dead. Why do you concentrate," he said, "on the passing episode as if it were his last work, as if the curtain dropped down on disaster and defeat? That dreadful scene lasted only several hours, but to the unending eternity, Christ is alive." Could we say amen for Michelangelo? Amen! Christ rules, he reigns, he triumphs still yet today. Later that day, and throughout the next few days and weeks, hope returns to this world. Christ is risen! He's risen indeed. Jesus gave death a knockout punch. There was a Dean, that 6'2", 50-inch chest, 29, that guy I told you about, he gave a great line yesterday. He said, when Jesus punched out death, Jesus was bad. And he was. And because he was bad, it's good for us. Good Friday was a dark and dreary day, but now Sunday has come. The Lord's defeated death once and for all, and he's come back to lead his disciples to victory. His comeback, which you and I as believers refer to as the resurrection, is the greatest comeback of all times. He came back from death, never to die again. You see, Jesus raised others from the dead, Lazarus, okay, and a child. But guess what? They were raised from the dead only to die again. But Jesus was raised from the dead never to die again. Why? So that you and I have hope that though we die, yet shall we still live. That is our hope. While we're here on this Easter Sunday and we're on the subject of the Christian comeback known as the resurrection, I'd like to let you know that there are even state governments at some level, they're bureaucratic, they are not theological, but state governments even believe in the resurrection. Let me give you one example. On Google, I found half a dozen, but let me just share one this morning. In Greenville, South Carolina, the Department of Social Services wrote to one of their welfare recipients, "Your food stamps will be stopped effective immediately because we have received notice that you passed away. You may reapply if there is a change in your circumstances." I personally know of only one person who ever experienced those changes in circumstances, and he did not live in South Carolina. So you can talk about your comebacks all you want, your Texas A&M, Jennifer Capriati's, Ernie Evans, Brady, Elway. I firmly believe the truest and best comeback is Jesus Christ. Brett Blair described it this way. He said, "Bones recalcified, joints ligamented, muscles retendoned, the veins blood filled, the heart restarted, the nerves electrified, the skin saturated, and up from the grave he arose." Amen. Christ is risen. Okay, good. All right, good. Caught you off guard on that one, huh? I was just playing off Dell over here, all right? The classic comeback story contains one of two twists. It's either about an underdog who falters and then succeeds beyond his or her dreams, or it's about a champion who falls, fights hard, and makes a big return. Either way, it's about a person in pain whose pain is alleviated or who is able to see pain in a new perspective. That big guy, Dean Johnson, I was telling you about, when he got into high school and he started lifting weights, he didn't lift weights. He told us this, words out of his own mouth. He said, "I did not lift weights to play football. I did not lift weights to impress girls. He said, I lift weights so that I could get good back straps on my muscles so that when I hit somebody, it gave them as much pain as I felt." It's a desperate life, isn't it? Who the only way that you can think that you can relieve your pain is to inflict pain on someone else. But you see, the one who rose from the dead, he has come to help us find a different way to deal with the pain in our life. There's several, there's reversal of fortunes that are available to us. Somebody on the bottom now comes on top, or somebody is up against a great obstacle and now they've overcome, or somebody does a dramatic about face in their life and they take it in a whole nother direction. None of us ever hope that we need a comeback, but all of us need hope for a comeback during our life, don't we? None of us plan on wanting a comeback, but every one of us has needed a comeback. Great comeback stories give us hope. We can all relate to the experiences of spending time in difficult places where we've wondered if we could ever make it back. We all know what it feels like to have life disappoint us and not work out as we hoped. We've all been in seasons when we've longed for something better than what we're experiencing right now. We could all use a fresh start, a change of heart, a powerful spiritual surge and turnaround. I don't know what kind of challenge you might be facing today. It could be one of many. Maybe you're facing conflict. Maybe you're struggling to overcome an addiction or a controlling sin and you need a comeback from despair and darkness to victory. Perhaps you're overwhelmed at work, or maybe worse yet, you hate your job. Or maybe you can't find one, or you feel stuck in a dead-end job and it seems there's no way forward. Maybe you're going through a rough season academically. You're a student. You wonder, am I ever going to pass this class? Am I ever going to graduate? You need a dose of hope, an infusion of fresh strength. Maybe you have all the money and the resources in the world. Maybe your life has gone exactly as you planned it, and yet when you sit down in the evening in your chair, you still feel empty and purposeless. Maybe you're here today and you're grieving deeply because of loss. Someone close to you has died. You valued that relationship so much. You now need perspective in your pain. You need to journey forward in spite of grief. Maybe you're in the midst of a tragedy and there are no words to describe what you're going through. You simply hurt and it takes your breath away. Maybe it's a serious or deep disappointment and you simply want to know which way to go. When a difficult season descends on us, sometimes we're here for a short time, but at other times it seems like they last our entire life. It's never going to end. We long for a solution. We long to return to a place where an obstacle isn't a problem anymore. And the good news is that the life Jesus calls us all to enter is a life of comebacks. On one hand, might be the kind of comeback where we overcome the obstacle by God's incredible power. On the other hand, it might be a deeper sort of comeback where Jesus redeems the worst of our circumstances for His glory and for our best. And in this latter kind of comeback, maybe the problems we're wrestling with won't be solved, at least in our lifetime. Yet God gives us patience. He offers us His presence in the middle of our problems. And He says, by my patience being at work in your problem, others will see and know that I am God. The big hope ahead is that when we are at a low, God's hand is always reaching lower yet to reach us. God does not have alligator arms. Another sports term there, all right? The receiver with alligator's arms is the receiver that won't reach out for a ball because he's afraid of being hit. God does not have alligator arms. God has arms that reach all the way to where we are, no matter where that is. God offers to us freedom, strength, peace, and a risen Savior. Through fires and trials, God offers us an intimate, personal relationship with Him. This is not about being a member of New Hope Church or being a Baptist or a Presbyterian or a Methodist or a Catholic. This is about, do I know the risen Savior? When the women ran on Easter Sunday morning, where did they run to? They didn't run to the temple. They ran to the tomb. Why? Because they couldn't find Jesus in a temple. A dead Jesus in a tomb was better than no Jesus in a temple. And when they got to the tomb, they found He was risen. He was alive. In the story of the Garden of Eden, there's lots of examples in the Bible. Let me highlight just a couple. In the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve lived in paradise. They had everything they could imagine, and then they crashed and burned. I don't know of anybody who crashed further than Adam and Eve did. Perfection in paradise, to the bottom. But what does the Scripture say God did? God reached for them. He came to them. He came right next to the bush where they were hiding. And He said, I wonder where they are. Kind of like a parent does with a child who's hiding and thinking they can't be seen. And yet they know right where they are. God knew right where Adam. He came to them to do for them what they couldn't do for themselves. The story of Noah in Genesis 6 through 9. Noah built this big boat, gathered all the animals, saved a remnant of humanity from complete destruction. It's a story we like to tell children because it has fuzzy animals and a rainbow and a happy ending. But guys, the story of Noah is not all nice. Right after Noah and his family were saved, they climbed out of the boat onto dry ground under this beautiful rainbow. But one of the first things Noah did was he planted a vineyard. It must have been a fast-growing vineyard because the next verse says he got drunk. Maybe this is where the term drunken sailor originated from. I came up with that one all by myself this week. That was so good. Yes, he saved the world, but Noah also had a major problem. Eric, he could have used CR. Noah had a problem. He had a hurt, a habit, and a hang-up, and he needed some help. His action caused a big conflict in the family. Fortunately, that's not the end of the story, because we can go to Hebrews 11, and we know there's more to the story, and it describes how Noah became an heir of righteousness in keeping with his faith. Noah had a comeback, and God used Noah powerfully. Abraham is another guy who could have used Celebrate Recovery. He had a problem with patience. He couldn't wait on God's timing, and he rushed ahead of God and created all kinds of problems. But God gave him a comeback because eventually he gave him the child of promise, and that child of promise gave to Abraham descendants as many as the stars of the sky and the sand of the sea. There's Moses, who came back from murder and rebellion, and Job, oh man, is there a comeback story? He lost it all. David committed adultery and murder and still developed a heart and a passion for God. Just like some of those 50-odd guys yesterday, you have some new brothers in Christ. Amen. Who were once murderers. Weren't they? Weren't some of those guys? They're in there for murder. They're not getting out, but they're going up. Isn't that good? Yeah. And some of them, God will find a way because he can use them greater on the outside than he can on the inside, and he'll get their release some way. We leave that in his hands. But God gives us comebacks. He's the master of giving to his children a song in the darkest of nights. The songwriter Asaph sounded this similar refrain in Psalm 77 when he said, "I call to remembrance my song in the night." The psalmist expressed great confidence in God when he said, "Yet the Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime, and in the night his song shall be with me. And there, and my prayer unto God for my life." We need songs in the dark nights, don't we? George A. Young in 1903 penned these words to a chorus. I think I shared them just a few weeks ago. "Some through the waters, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long." You find yourself in a dark night of the soul right now, that God would like to give you a song. Psalm 43:5 says, "Why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him." David said, when I'm in the pit, the way out of the pit is to get my eyes off the pit and start praising God. We lift our hands for one of two reasons. We lift our hands because of jubilant celebration. Okay, now, not all of us raise our hands in church. Okay, I was raised Baptist. We have our hands in our pockets when we stand and sing. Okay, I finally learned I could do this. Okay, and then I eventually got to where this. Okay. And then I could get one up. And now on occasions, and you don't have to. But man, okay, think about it this way. When you were at a football game or a baseball game and a play goes away, you want it, what do? Yeah! Jubilant celebration. So if you don't do that in church, you do it somewhere. Okay? That's praise. That's raising our hands. We also raise our hands for another reason. We raise our hands when there's nothing else that we can do. I quit. God, I don't know what to do. Whatever the situation is, raise your hands and praise to God. Forget the circumstances. Praise Him, and He'll begin to give you a song in the dark night. There are two things I want to say to you if you're here today and you're in a dark place right now. Number one, you're not crazy. Look at the person to your right. Say, you're not crazy. Look at the person on your left. Say, you're not crazy. Hey. Some of you aren't too sure about that, are you? Yeah. But you're not. Here's the second thing. We got to wrap this up. So shut up. Okay? So. You're not supposed to say, I know, I should not have said shut up, okay? You're not to ever say that. Okay, yeah. So, you're not crazy. Number two, you're not alone. You are not alone. Psalm 23:4, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will not be afraid. Why? Because you are with me. Who is the one who is with me? The one who spent 3 days in a tomb. Yes. He knows the valley of the shadow of death. Yes. And he's lit in the light and he said, get away from me, darkness. Life rules here. And whatever the deep dark pit is that you are in, forget about the people who made you mad. Forget about the circumstances that have you humbled, simply either in despair or in celebration. Praise him. And he'll give you a song in the night, and morning will come. There's a comeback. The solution is to praise Christ. Let me wrap this up. That's the invitation of the empty tomb. That's the invitation of this message. If you're in a dry, weary place right now, praise him. If you're in the valley of the shadow of death, praise him. Tim, how can I? Because if you don't praise him, there's a good chance that you don't trust him. And if you don't trust him, then I don't care how real the resurrection is, it's of no use to you. But when we believe that he was raised from the dead, we believe we can come back from wherever it is that we are. The comeback God offers us can start right now because the resurrection is true. Remember that verse I read to you out of 1 Corinthians 15? If Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless and so is your faith. Verse 20 is the comeback. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead and the first fruits of those who have already died. In other words, God is the first of many and you can be part of the many if you'll put your faith in Jesus Christ. Life, eternal life, will be yours. Would you like to receive him today? Would you like to be restored to a comeback starting today? Amen. Then why not just humble yourself? There's no formula. This is a matter of faith, not formula. Why don't you bow your heads with me right now and just pray? Using your own words, a thief on a cross said, remember me today. You've done nothing wrong. I deserve what I'm getting. Jesus, you're holy. I stink. Remember me. And Jesus said, today you'll be with me. So Lord, thank you for listening. Most of all, Lord, thank you for giving us the greatest comeback ever. That gives us hope for our own comebacks. And whatever challenges, whatever darkness folks may be facing at this moment, may they realize that your Son is the light of the world and he can shine bright light into their deepest, darkest pit and will begin to show us the way out. It starts with praise. It starts with trust. So, Father, thank you for hearing. Thank you for reaching. Thank you for doing what you did to Adam and Eve generations and generations ago. Thank you for doing the same thing then, today. You've come here and you are whispering, where are you, Bob? Where are you, Mary? Where are you, Fred? Where are you? You know right where we are. You were just waiting for us to come to you. But Father, you've cut the distance very, very short. It's just a turn of our heart that says, God, I trust, I believe, I give you my life. Thank you for hearing our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. Happy Easter. God bless you.